It's really quite a pleasure to host Will Schwalbe. He's written a book that's very easy for a bookstore to love because it's a book about books. Will reads lots of books. In fact, he spends his work days editing books. And in his spare time, he clearly writes books, too. His last one, which I'm sure many of you have read, was the New York Times bestseller, The End of Your Life Book Club. It told the story of how Will and his mother discussed books during the final months of her life, a testament to the power of literature to help people cope with the immediate challenges of their lives and with deeper existential questions. It also was very simply a lovely tribute to Will's mom. This time in Books for Living, Will is making a case more than telling a story. The work is a collection of essays about 26 books, some well-known, some not, across a range of genres, books that have affected Will's life in some way or another. What it's not is one of those greatest hits anthologies or a contrived list of favorites. Through the books he chooses to write about, Will offers commentary on why someone may be attracted to a certain book and what that person brings to the experience of reading it. And he uses these essays as jumping off points into a range of other topics. Underpinning all his pieces, too, is a strong argument in favor of reading. He writes in the introduction, we need to read and be readers now more than ever. And you know, he wrote those lines even before the November 8th election. Will has enjoyed several careers, though all have been related in some way or another to words and ideas. He was a journalist before he entered the publishing industry. In publishing, he became an editor, then rose to be editor-in-chief of Hyperion. He left that job in 2008 to start a cooking website called cookster.com that featured recipes from great chefs and cookbook authors. He sold the site to Macmillan a few years ago, then joined Macmillan, where he now serves as executive vice president for editorial development and content innovation. We have a motto here at P&P. You can see it on our T-shirts that says, so many books, so little time. I think if Will had a T-shirt, it would say, all books, all the time. And we certainly aren't going to complain about that. So, ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Will Schwalbe.
Wow, thank you so much for that wonderful introduction. That was so thoughtful and complete. As I'm starting to do these events, this is my second. One friend noting how many friends and family also tend to show up these as long as all sorts of people said that it's almost like your memorial service. but when that time comes, I would love for you to speak at mine because you did that just beautifully. So first I'm going to say greetings and happy new year. And it is very meaningful to be here in a bookstore with so many book lovers, given everything that's going on around us in the world. And it just feels more important than ever. Not only do we need books, we need each other. And so to have you all here and all be book lovers, my tribe, is fantastic. Now, Books for Living is a book that starts with a nightmare. And the nightmare is this. I always have this nightmare. I'm at an airport, and I'm about to get on a plane for Perth. I don't know why Perth. I've never been to Perth, but it's always Perth. And I realize just as I'm about to board the plane that I don't have a book. I don't have a single book. I have nothing to read. And then, as I'm sure all of you would too, panic. Sheer panic, terror ensues. And in this horrible, horrible nightmare, I find myself running through the airport, trying to find any book anywhere, and there's not a single book. And then they start calling, last call, they're calling me by my name, Mr. Schwalbe, please get it. And I realize that if I don't run to the gate that second, I will miss my flight to Perth. And yet, I can't do it. And I keep running through the airport, and invariably, I wake up screaming. I call that the reader's nightmare. Now, I'm guessing some of you have had that too, and I don't know if any of you have had its sort of happy corollary, which I call the real estate dream. The real estate dream is where you are dreaming, and it's a very happy dream. You're puttering around your apartment in your dream, and you open a closet, and there's an entire wing of your apartment or house that you never knew existed. It's like a second bedroom, or a ballroom, a swimming pool, a formal library. So that's the happy one. And I love that one, but I don't love the reader's nightmare. And so when I started to write this book, I started to think, what is it about the reader's nightmare? Why is it so terrifying to be without a book? Why is it okay to be on a flight without, I don't dream about there not being food. If I didn't have tunes, that would be okay. If the entertainment console didn't work, that would be okay. But there's something about books. And in Books for Living, I try to answer that question. What is it about books? Now, throughout my life, I've looked to books for all sorts of reasons. I've looked to them to comfort me, to distract me, to educate me. And I really believe that everything you need to know, you can find in a book. But that doesn't mean it's always easy to find the right book at the right time. So what Books for Living is about some of the books that I found or that found me when I needed them most. And yes, these are not necessarily my favorite books. In fact, most of my favorite books aren't mentioned in this book. But these are all books that helped me figure out something when I needed to figure it out, and that something was how to live a more meaningful life. Or these are books that helped me understand the life I'd already lived. And they're all books that I hope can do the same for you. Now, I should add that I believe all different kinds of books have something to teach us. So I write about a really eclectic lot. For example, I write about The Girl on the Train, which is a contemporary suspense novel, and very popular, which I enjoyed enormously. I think the great thing about thrillers and suspense novels is they help you with a very valuable skill, especially in this town. They help you know whom you can trust. And the great thing about this one, Girl on the Train, is that there are three narrators, and one of them, our main narrator, and don't worry, there are no spoilers. I never do spoilers. One of our narrators, our main narrator, is not even sure she can trust herself. And I think that's a pretty valuable lesson as you go about life, that as you look at everything going around you, and you're so sure that you're right about something, I think to The Girl on the Train, and I think, maybe I'm the untrustworthy one. Maybe I don't remember that correctly. Maybe I'm wrong. Maybe I should check. And I talk about all different kinds of books, children's books, including picture books, cookbooks, classic books, contemporary books. And very often, and I think this is true of all real readers, that the lesson I draw from a book is a really unexpected lesson. So I'm going to read you a little passage about the unexpected lesson that I got from Homer's Odyssey. And then I'll go on chatting. Here's the passage. I had a wonderful and very intimidating high school classics teacher named Mr. Tracy. He was highly theatrical. He had been a Shakespearean actor in Canada, the land of his birth, and he was notoriously tough. He didn't treat us as children. He treated us as adults who had simply neglected, as of yet, to learn all they were supposed to have learned. One of the most important things I would ever learn came in my first few weeks with Mr. Tracy, and it was a lesson in learning. The assignment was simple, a paper on some classical topic about which little is known or can be learned. But I'd worked hard, or at least many hours, and I was convinced I had created a work of brilliance. As a result, I was excited to get the paper back a few days later, and then bitterly disappointed to discover that Mr. Tracy had given me a C. I asked to see Mr. Tracy after class. "Excuse me, sir," I said somewhat tentatively, "but I really think I deserved a B." Mr. Tracy looked at me with no discernible emotion. Then he pulled out a big red felt tip marker. He carefully crossed out the C. And then he wrote a big B and gave it back to me. But not before he paused and asked a key question. Are you sure you don't want an A? Since I hadn't been prepared for quick victory, and I had a whole speech at the ready, I didn't know what to say. But then I realized where this was going. Mr. Tracy waited a moment and then said, it's a C paper. No matter what grade I put on it, it's still a C paper. But I'm happy to give it a B or even an A. In fact, why don't you just tell me what grade you want when you hand in each paper for the rest of the term and save me the trouble of grading them? Then Mr. Tracy really went for it. In fact, why don't you just tell me what grade you want for the whole course and then you don't have to show up at all? I had to beg Mr. Tracy to give me my C back, and eventually I got it. Now, what I thought I learned that day was not to grade grub. But on reflection, I now realize that what Mr. Tracy taught me that day was to recognize my mediocrity. And that, in fact, the essence of learning is to do just that. When you embrace mediocrity, you embrace humility. You learn to see that no matter how good you are at something, the world probably has people who are more talented at it than you are. You can strive to learn from people who do things better, or you can at least appreciate them, even if you don't want to be them. By definition, most of us are mediocre, and everyone is mediocre at something. Oh, I do have to pause from reading in a second. That by definition, most of us are mediocre. I love the story of someone who was addressing a whole room full of doctors and said, did you know that half the doctors graduated in the bottom 50% of their class at medical school? And everyone was like, no. Tells you something. So, by definition, most of us are mediocre, and everyone is mediocre at something. When we denigrate mediocrity, we discourage ourselves and others from trying new things. It would be great to be a great painter, but it's also great just to paint, or sing, or throw pots, or knit scarves, or play chess. And remember, this is a chapter about the Odyssey. Even Odysseus would have had to admit that he didn't do a great job getting home. Odysseus was great at many things, war, building Trojan horses, to name just two. But he was thoroughly mediocre at getting home. Others managed it in months. It took Odysseus a full decade. But the lesson is, that's okay. You don't have to be great at getting home, so long as you eventually get there. Odysseus's return to Ithaca is a solid C-level performance. Far from an A, but by no means a failure. Now, that's a little excerpt from the book. And it's an example of one of the things that I love about reading, which is that what you learn from any book is entirely up to you. I often take away from a book, in fact, exactly the opposite of what the author intended. For example, the wonderful Japanese novelist Haruki Murakami, who's one of my favorite novelists, wrote a little book about running marathons. And it's called What I Talk About When I Talk About Running. It's a terrific book, and it's about these grueling feats of endurance. And I took away one thing from that book, which is one paragraph about napping. Just in one paragraph, Murakami talks about how much he loves to nap. And I love napping, too. So as I lay in bed, fully clothed, reading that book, for me, that book became a book about taking naps. I should say that there are some interesting parallels between running and napping. He describes this altered state when you're running and how your mind goes to a kind of special place. And that's where my mind goes when I nap, too. But napping has a real benefit that running doesn't, which is if you combine reading and napping, you can insert yourself into whatever book you're reading. So you can be on the moors with Heathcliff, if that's what you're reading as you take a nap. Or I put into the book that while I was reading a certain book by Mitch Albom, I found myself spending Mondays and Wednesdays with Maury. And actually, when the copy editor was going over the book, she said, why aren't you spending Tuesdays with Maury? And I said, because that's when he's with Mitch. But there's one book in particular that I begin and end with, and I come back to time and time again, and that's a book called The Importance of Living. Now, this book was one of the biggest bestsellers of the 1930s. Its author was a Chinese scholar. His name was Lin Yutang. And Pearl Buck, the Nobel Prize-winning author of The Good Earth, among other books, was in China with her husband when she met him. And her husband, who was a great publisher, offered Lin Yutang a book contract. He moved to the U.S., to New York, put his kids into the Dalton School, and proceeded to write two enormous bestsellers in a row. The first was a book explaining China to the West, and the next was this book, The Importance of Living, which he described as a book about the noble art of leaving things undone. Now, I stumbled across this book in a kind of odd way, and one of the things I talk about in Books for Living is the peculiar way that we do wind up finding some of the books that are most important to us. For this book, I had been obsessively watching Cabaret because I was in love with Michael York, who wasn't. And that led me to Christopher Isherwood, who became my favorite writer. And reading about Isherwood in the 30s kept leading me to the name Lin Yutang and this monster bestseller that no one had heard of and had been out of print for decades. So I come back again and again to this book because I think it's a book that speaks really extraordinarily to our times. Lin wrote this in 1937. And he talks about how incredibly frenetic life had become and about the pressures on people's time and about greed and ambition and about all of the things that he saw taking place across Europe and Asia. He talks specifically about the rise of Hitler and Stalin, but he talks also about a kind of humanism. And for Lin, the antidote to this greed and ambition was to return to humanistic values. It was about spending time with one's friends. It was about enjoying tea and food. It was about reading all different kinds of work, poetry, literature, the literatures of the world. And this concept that he had about being a reasonable man or reasonable person. And this book really, as I was writing Books for Living, became even more of a touchstone for me, and I kept coming back to it again and again, because this theme is one that I think we need to address increasingly now. I also write in Books for a Living about 1984, George Orwell's unfortunately unbelievably prescient book. But one of the things that struck me reading Orwell again was telescreens. And he talks about these telescreens and their people spying on us everywhere. And then I thought about the little telescreen that I carry with me and the fact that Orwell was both right and wrong. There are telescreens everywhere, but we do the spying on ourselves. And I thought about Anne Morrow Lindbergh's Gift from the Sea, which is a wonderful book where she goes to the seashore. And in the shells that she finds is inspired to think about her priorities and her busy life and her rushing around. And to carve out more time for herself. She has one thing which I thought was so priceless because it's something that happens to me all the time. She said, someone will call and say, what are you doing Tuesday night? And if you don't have anything in your calendar for Tuesday night, for some reason you feel compelled to say nothing, and then off you are. If you were having dinner with a friend, you'd say, I'm having dinner with a friend. But she says, it's really okay to say Tuesday night, I'm going to spend some time with myself. You don't have to lie. Just say you're making your own time. Does everyone know the Marie Kondo book, The Life-Changing Magic of Tidying Up? That was a book where she basically encourages you to throw out most of your stuff. It is, I think, a book that was probably causing more divorces than any other single book. But when I think about Anne Morrow Lindbergh, what I really think is it's the life-changing magic of tidying up for your soul. And again, back to Lin Yutang, he has an extraordinary image in his book, which is he talks about the most famous tea house in China. And he said, tourists from all over the world, they come to this tea house. And then he said, when they get to the tea house, they're so busy taking pictures of themselves drinking tea that they forget to enjoy the tea. So I include that. I include some books that are certainly classics, Song of Solomon. I think some modern classics like A Little Life by Hanya Yanagihara. I write about Death Be Not Proud, which remains an incredibly meaningful book for me about Johnny Gunther, who got a brain tumor, and his father, who was one of the world's great journalists, chronicling the last years of Johnny's life. But I also include some really lesser known books. And one of my favorites that I'm just determined to get lots of people to read is called A Journey Around My Room. Has anyone who hasn't read my book heard of A Journey Around My Room? This was written in 1790 by a count who had been dueling. And dueling was illegal then, as we all know from seeing Hamilton. He had been sentenced to 40 days of house arrest. They didn't have ankle bracelets there. It was kind of a trust system. So he had these 40 days in 1790. And what he decided to do was write a travel guide to his room. So he visits different places in his room. One day he visits his bed and describes that as though it were another country. He visits his chest of drawers. He visits a wall. He visits a picture. And he does this really cool thing. He gets in his chair and he scooches around like that. So that's how he travels, diagonally. But it actually turns out to be, at first you think it's quite a frivolous book, and it turns out to be incredibly moving. He visits the letters that a comrade wrote to him, a comrade, a fellow warrior who died in his arms of disease. And he visits the window. And when he looks out the window, he says, "You don't have to travel to distant lands to see children huddling together for warmth to keep from freezing to death. You can look at it right outside your window." And what this book turns out to be, at first you think it's really silly, is it's a real meditation on the things that are most important and the fact that we pay so little attention to what's right here in front of us. Another kind of peculiar chapter, I would say, but one that did seem to me to be a chapter for the times, even though I did write it before recent events, is a chapter about a children's book called More, 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 Said the Baby. And More, 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 Said the Baby is an adorable children's book about how toddlers and infants just want, whatever you're doing, they want more, 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 and as much love and attention as you have to give, they will soak up and they will still want more. And I pair that with Plutarch's Lives, where Plutarch chronicled the lives of Roman and Greek generals, admirable ones and not admirable ones. And really what I realized reading those two books in quick succession was that what is adorable in infants is not so adorable in adults. Much of the book is about books that help me live every day, but a lot of the books also are about books that are more reflective and help me remember, for example, people I've loved who have lost. And I think that's another incredible thing that books can do for you, that books and people are bound together, and maybe someone gave you a book, and when you read that book, you remember them. Or maybe a book, just in a very strange sense-memory way, brings someone back who you hadn't thought of for years. I write about The Little Prince, and how that book brought back a friend of mine named Lee Harkins, who died when we were sophomores in high school. And I write about David Copperfield, which is one of my favorite books, and how, when I finished that book, I was just sobbing because I thought that was the last I would ever see of David Copperfield, that I wouldn't have him in my life anymore, having spent 800 pages with him and with Steerforth and with little Emily and with Dora. And I realized when I finished that book, that wasn't the end of my relationship with David Copperfield, that was really the start of a lifelong relationship with David Copperfield. And I write about my best friend who was killed in a tragic accident 2 years after we graduated from college, and his name was David. And how, when I think of David Copperfield, I can either remember the experience of finishing the book in my sadness, or I can remember the whole wonderful book. I can remember David Copperfield's entire life. And when I think of my friend David Baer, I get to choose whether I remember the strange and tragic way he was killed, or whether I remember his entire life and our times together. So that's a thing I think books can do too, is they can't bring people back, but they can keep them close. I really believe that books can save your life. I talk about this in a very prosaic way, because I talk about a guy named Jason Derfus, who was a student who was caught up in the middle of a mass shooting. And when he got home, his enormous biography of the medieval philosopher John Wycliffe had stopped a bullet that was intended for him. So he did say that book saved his life. But I talk about it actually in a much more existential way, which is certain books like Reading Lolita in Tehran, Giovanni's Room, The Perks of Being a Wallflower, I Know Why the Caged Birds Sing. These are books that people cite again and again as books that saved their life. And everybody might have a different one, and you might not have one, but it's astonishing the number of people who use that phrase. And to that end, there's a wonderful passage I quote from James Baldwin. And he wrote, "You think your pain and heartbreak are unprecedented in the history of the world, but then you read. It was books that taught me that the things that tormented me most were the very things that connected me with all the people who were alive or who had ever been alive." Now, near the end of Books for Living, I tell the story of a woman I met in a bookstore in Neptune, Florida, a great indie bookstore. And I asked her, "What are you reading?" And she launched into a story. She told me that she was a fiction reader, but that her husband had been a big nonfiction reader, history, biography, and that he'd been very, very ill the last years of his life. And he kept starting books, but finding himself unable to finish them. And he would leave a bookmark in every book that he was unable to finish where he stopped. And when he died, there was a huge stack of books with bookmarks in them, some in the first couple pages and some just a few pages from the end. So when I'd asked her, what are you reading? She said to me, "I'm reading all those books. I'm finishing the books for my husband that he couldn't finish for himself. I'm reading them start to finish. He can't read because he's no longer here, so I'm doing it for him." So over the course of the book, I write about a lot of people from my life who aren't here anymore, and I write about the AIDS crisis and various other things. And in the end, I come down to a kind of equation, which is, I called my book Books for Living, but it's a lot about people who aren't here. And what is it we can do for the dead? What is it we can do for the people we loved who aren't here anymore? Well, one of the things, of course, is we can live more thoughtful lives. We can read books, and not just read them. We can take their messages to heart. When we read novels, we can vow to be more empathetic. When we learn about situations in our country and around the world, we can vow to do something about them. But we can also quite literally read for the dead. And by that I mean, we can read books they loved, or we can read books that we think our friends or family members might have loved. Because when we read those books in that way, it in some ways keeps them close. And I believe that reading in that way can help us answer questions they might have had. It can help us pose questions to which they might have an answer. And I quote in one chapter a wonderful poem by Marie Howe, which is called To My Dead Friends, which is about that very topic. But it also can help us consider how to continue their legacy. And before we go to questions, and I hope we have questions as well as book suggestions, I just want to read a passage from the very end of my book. So I suppose I should say this is a spoiler alert. Lin Yutang urged us to appreciate poetry and literature, not just as good things in and of themselves, but also because they encourage a kind of humanized thinking that he felt was essential for the survival of our race. Lin believed that hope for our world resides in people's adopting what he called the spirit of reasonableness, which he saw in the best of the Chinese traditions. And his quote, "No one can be perfect. He can only aim at being a likable, reasonable human being." Books remain one of the strongest bulwarks we have against tyranny, but only as long as people are free to read all different kinds of books, and only as long as they actually do so. The right to read whatever you want, whenever you want, is one of the fundamental rights that helps preserve all the other rights. It's a right we need to guard with unwavering diligence, but it's also a right we can guard with pleasure. Reading isn't just a strike against narrowness, mind control, and domination. It's one of the world's great joys. How we live is no trivial matter. Racing around in a state of agitation and greed and envy isn't just wasting our lives. It's a symbol of much that's wrong with the world. And reading all different kinds of books is not simply reading all different kinds of books. It's a way of becoming more fully human and more humane. When I read, I'm reminded to be thoughtful of how I approach each day. And that's not just important for the living. It's the least I can do for the dead. I read to live. I read for life. Thank you. So I'd love questions, comments, book suggestions. Yes. Oh, yes, to the mic. I'm sorry.
Okay, I'm coming. It'll take me a minute.
Okay.
So I was listening to NPR on the way here, and this is the 10th anniversary of the introduction of the iPhone.
Yeah.
Is a book like this a tough sell in an environment when there are so many distractions and reading seems to be considered a little bit less sexy than it used to be?
I think actually that people are really hungering for books. And I think in an iPhone world, people know that they're being distracted. And I think the best test for a book if you're thinking about writing a book was given to me by a dear friend in publishing, which he said to me, write the book you need. I spend way too much time on my iPhone. And I'm a passionate reader, an enormous reader, but I realized that I needed to reset my own clock and time. And I feel that hunger really wherever I go. So I think in an iPhone world, people need books more than ever. The question I get a lot is, how do you make time for it? How do you fit reading into the kinds of schedules we all have? And that's actually super easy. And the answer comes from Lin Yu Tang, which is you read when you wake up in the morning and you set your alarm a half hour early and you read for a half hour. And it's a magical thing because you look forward to the morning. I find people always set themselves really grim tasks in the morning, like the treadmill, and then they dread it. But if you do that, and just one other thing about that question, which is it's such a wonderful question. And it's interesting in terms of generations, because I find among very young people, books are the easiest sell in the world. Kids love books. And something happens somewhere along the way to make them lose that. So I think part of our challenge as a society is to mirror for the young people our own relationship with books.
I have two questions. One is, do you feel compelled always to finish a book? And secondly, could you tell us what your two favorite books are and why? Because I'm not sure that they're
not in here. No. So I usually feel compelled to skim my way to the end of a book. So if I'm not enjoying it, I will flip through rapid fire to find out basically what's going to happen and see if also something interrupts me. Sometimes I find that I think I don't want to finish and I start skimming and then something comes and I'm like, oh, I do want to finish this book. And then I go back and read carefully. And there are some books, too, which I think should come with warnings. One of my favorite books is a book called At Swim, Two Boys. And it's by an Irish writer named Jamie O'Neill. And a dear friend gave it to me. It's a huge book. And she said the first 50 pages are torture. She said, on page 49, you're going to be saying, I hate this book, and why did my friend give it to me? But she said, go to page 51, and it becomes magic. And I was absolutely right. So I wish as publishers we could put honest flap copy. I wish we could say, like, you know, the first 50 pages are torture, but keep going. But we can't. As far as my two favorite books, my favorite author by far is Christopher Isherwood, and his autobiography, Christopher and His Kind, which is about moving to Berlin in the 30s and about the young man he fell in love with who was German and they were both pacifists. It's a true story. It's his memoir. And it's about how they were chased all across Europe by the Gestapo. It's an extraordinary book. And one of the things that's extraordinary about it is Isherwood writes it in two voices, Christopher and I. And so he says, Christopher went to Berlin for this reason, but I know that it was actually this other reason. And it really changed the way I looked at my life, that I realized that I and Will are two different people. And the other thing, I would probably say the book that gave me the most extraordinary reading experience other than that is A Fine Balance by Rohinton Mystery. What's your favorite book?
Very often we're led to a book by a review that we read. And very often when I read a review of a book, I say to myself, I think the reviewer has gotten this book all wrong. And when I look at the book, I find that that's true. How do publishers get into the process of having reviewers selected? And how often do you think the reviewer is not the right reviewer for the book?
That is, so unfortunately, publishers have very limited ability, and usually the kiss of death is to suggest a reviewer, which absolutely guarantees that person won't and can't review the book. I think reviewers are wrong fully 90% of the time. And I think they're wrong in their enthusiasms as well as the things they disparage. I've been more led astray by great reviews of books that I thought were like, than I have been discouraged by reviewers knocking books. And I think reviewers, there's a couple of mistakes I just see again and again. One is they so often review the book they would have written had they been the writer, and they don't review the book that the writer wrote. And that makes me nuts. But I do think there's something really powerful about professional reviewers, because you at least get to know their taste. So at least you say, Michiko always hates this kind of thing. I always like this kind of thing. So if she hates it, I'm going to like it.
So I should just say that Will's book has gotten some very good reviews.
And I love those. I totally am complete agreement. They were right on the money.
That's the other 10%.
Right? Yeah, that's the other 10%.
So my question is, you know, as I mentioned in my introductory remarks, you wrote the book in your introduction before the recent election. We're getting lots of questions from customers, you know, what do I read to make me feel better? What suggestions would you have?
I don't know if reading to feel better is what I would actually advise anybody. I think I would advise people to read to feel things more deeply. I think it's a time for whatever you feel to feel it far more intensely than you've ever felt it before. But if you are of revolutionary in spirit, I would read Nikki Giovanni's early poetry from the Black Arts Movement. I would read books about major turning points in our history. I'd read Bury My Heart at Wounded Knee. I would read books about the Civil Rights Movement. I'd read John Lewis's magnificent
trilogy,
graphic novel trilogy. And I would do something which I think people should do all the time, which was I would also seek out books, good books that people have told you are good, reasonable books from the people most different from you. And I would read those books, whether it's memoir, narrative nonfiction, or especially fiction.
Sending these customers to you.
That's.
I love to read books, but I have another problem relating to books, which the management likes, of course. I buy books, I collect books, I go to junk shops and get books, I go to the flea market and get books, and they're on my shelf and it looks nice, the decorators think so, but I am going to go to heaven or elsewhere without having read all of them. What is your advice to me on how to attack that problem?
That's a great problem. And I think your words are probably shared by everyone here. It's funny, when non-readers come in my apartment and they see all the books stacked all over the place, they say, have you read all of those? And I say, of course not. I'm keeping them around because I might want to. And the kind of corollary of the reader's nightmare for me is I'll see a book in a great bookstore like Politics and Prose, and I'll think like, ooh, I'm going to want that sometime. You know, I might not want to read it right now, but I know there's going to come a time when I'm going to want to read it, so I want to have it. And I wish I had some advice. I do tell the story, which is not me, but of a wonderful friend. And there's a chapter in the book about this. This is a chapter on Song of Solomon, who was a professor who had a collection of literally tens of thousands of books. And when he was in his 70s, he gave them all away to libraries. And he decided that for the rest of his life, he would keep exactly 100 books. And it was a zero-sum formula. He read voraciously. He bought books voraciously. But he would give them away unless it was one that he felt could be one of the 100. And then he would put on the shelf, but then he had to give another book away. And when he died, and he died well into his 80s, he left a kind of autobiography in titles. He left 100 books that defined who he was, which I thought was marvelous. And I was the beneficiary of his rabid book buying and giving away, so it was great for me. Do you, are you out of space, or do you still have room?
I'm out of space. They're stacked on the floor.
Yeah, yeah.
And to get away from substance, here I'm doing the Ottoman Empire, I have adventure stories, and I recommend to anybody who likes adventure and drama to read things that a lot of people don't read. I have a full set of John Buchan.
Great.
Lord Tweedsmuir. Fabulous. He wrote 39 Steps. That's the only one that anybody else knows about. And I have two complete sets, that one of which I got from my father, who would be 110 were he alive, E. Phillips Oppenheim. I recommend
all you. All right. E. Duly Phillips noted.
Oppenheim. My shelf of Oppenheim is that long.
Great. Thank you.
Hi, nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
The way I do the books is I figure I read 10 or 20 a year, which isn't very much, and I figure I have 10 or 20 years of reading, so I look at a book and I say, is this going to be one of those 200? And I, knowing that there will be others that I will want to read. So, but I just wanted to mention that I read your book, The End of Your Life Book Club, and I gave it to my mother, who was dying of cancer, and it was actually, I think, the last book that she read. And yet, somehow, while she was reading it, and we were reading it together, and so it was kind of a nice parallel to your story, I guess, she recognized that your mother was someone that her stepdaughter or her stepdaughter knew and had worked with refugees. So,
oh, that's wonderful.
So it was a lovely little moment. And yeah. So, and maybe I can chat with you about your mom and her.
Oh, I would love that.
Anyway, thank you very much.
Oh, thank
that.
You. And I'm very touched that you and your mother read
we
that.
We really loved it. Yeah.
Oh, thank you. Thank you so much. Yeah. I mean, it's sort of along the lines of what I was saying too, the way that books and people connect, and that the way then those books and people are bound together. Including this connection to my mother, and it's I love how books bring people together. And one of the things about being here too is I have this line in the book where I say books are one of the few things you do by yourself that make you feel less alone, not more alone. But that said, this idea of third spaces, places that aren't our home and aren't our office, where we come together and meet each other physically, and this relates to the question about the iPhones, which are so impersonal. I think third places are way more important than ever before in an iPhone era. And bookstores, like Politics and Prose, are the kind of, for me, the magical third place where you get to meet other readers and find out these connections that we all have. And they're so much more meaningful than sitting around endlessly a Starbucks, which is actually not really a third place. It's just another place where people stare at their laptops, which we have plenty.
I can't resist. If you were a revolutionary trying not to get young children to love books, which is much easier than by the time they discover devices, which is now digital devices, which is now younger and younger, how would you get college students hooked on reading?
So, I mean, I think one of the most valuable things for college students to get them hooked on reading, or high school students for that matter, too. You'll take high school students. Is I think that one of the dangers, and I hope I don't play into this, of talking about books in a somewhat emotional and maybe even slightly sentimental way, is that it undersells how dangerous books are in a great way. The books can be incendiary, profane, they can be dangerous in so many different ways. And so I think for college students or even high school students, I would give them dangerous books, however that is defined for them. But there's also, I had this question once from someone who told me very specifically that he was a huge reader and his little brother wasn't a reader, and he really wanted his little brother to be a reader. And I said, well, if I gave you a book that was a biography of your little brother, would he read that? And he said, well, of course he'd read that. It's a biography of him. And I said, you have to find a book that feels like a biography to him. You have to find a book that speaks to him so much that he feels like he's reading his own story. And if you can do that, he'll read it. Especially if you, older brother, say, I think this book has your number. Like, this book has you nailed. But it's not easy. And I also do fully accept that people have different styles of learning, and that many people are visual or auditory and don't have the same relationship to the words on the page. And I think that's different. You would know on them. I do think for most people, it's really about finding the right book. And getting books out of that realm of being sort of bland and good for you.
Well, thank you so much, and I really appreciate the license to be consistently adequate. I find
great.
That very freeing. So thank you for that. But I want to follow up a little bit about this, because I'm not an educator, but I'm a parent, and I raised two girls who love to read. And I think that one of the things that I did was that I never made them read. I remember we had a nanny. And she said, I think the girls should read 20 minutes every day. And I said, I think the girls should love to read. Please don't make them read. Do not make it a chore. And I think that one of the things that we lose is story. I think we all love stories. And as soon as you assign a second grader to start writing a book review and analyzing a story, you just killed it.
Yeah, yeah.
And I just also, so I just was curious about your view on this, because this in writing this, did it wreck any of the magic of any of those stories as you were doing the analysis of it? I'm just curious about that.
Well, because I am spectacularly shallow in my analysis, and I mean that for real, it didn't wreck it at all. I mean, one of the sort of criticisms that I take most pride in is that I'm basically an enthusiastic reader, and I write about books I love, and I'm not so interested in figuring out how they work. I just like that they work. Yes, I think it would. If I were to go too deep in it, I think it would hurt the magic. One reviewer, which I loved, said it was like a mixture of Thomas Jefferson and Lisa Simpson from The Simpsons. I don't know what the Jefferson was about, but Lisa Simpson always has her face buried in a book. But yes, I think that school impulse of making people tear apart stories they like.
It's like wrecking a rattle.
Yeah. I also, not to rag on the education system, but there was a wonderful piece I read somewhere, and I can't remember where. Did anyone say about the poet who tried to answer the questions on standardized tests about her own poetry and found she was completely unable to answer them, mostly because it asked questions about things like the stanzas, which were printed incorrectly. But that's another story. Great. Oh, and I just have one thing that I like to say. Sorry. Oh, sorry, sir. Oop, careful.
Hi, I must begin with an apology. I'm a retired professor, and professors have a very bad reputation for understandable reasons in the way they handle books and the way they talk about books. But my question is this. Anybody who has taught students or tried to get students to read books, our worst moments probably are when they write about them. Because you read them, you read their essays, and you say, is this the book I read? where on earth did they get this or that? How did they completely miss such and such and thus and so? And it's not that they miss in unison, they miss in 100 different ways of what the author, for example, is trying to do. Now, you can do a Derrida and say, well, it's how they read it, that's what it means. My question is, reading without being taught to read troubles me a little bit, because we all, those of us who have read papers, are being awed by the anarchy of response.
Mm-hmm.
So, and this is where people like Derrida, that it doesn't matter what the author wanted to say. This is the way I feel about it. Is this where we're headed? That is, if we just read books, and all I'm saying is here, the university has been a very valuable institution in that it got us to read things. We just didn't wander around bookstores and pick up stuff and read them. What do you see is the relationship between pedagogy of some sort and reading?
It's a great question. And I'm so glad you pointed that out, because I was being somewhat flip in my approach, because obviously I had the benefit of an education.
Sure.
So I can sort of, as anyone has who has been taught, has the benefit of being able to choose to read in an uncritical fashion, knowing that you're in some ways turning off the critical facility in order to get swept up and raptured. But of course, probably the critical facility is operating nonetheless. And I went to Yale during the height of the madness and didn't care for that at all. I remember at one point a teacher saying to me, the text is whatever you make of it. And I felt like saying, well, why are we paying you? if that's true, why do I even go here? Why don't I just stay home and read stuff? And I do believe that it's really exciting to learn how to approach things in a rigorous way. And I believe in truth. I believe whether we're able to get it, it's exciting to try to get there. And exciting to get there together, which is one of the reasons I'm such a proponent of this kind of thing, of meeting and talking about books, because we can educate one another. I think there is the Scylla and Charybdis of analyzing a book to death on this side and reading it in a completely ignorant and uncritical way on that side. And the pendulum swings back and forth. But there's quite a marvelous book. I thought so. A very popular book. And I was the beneficiary of a blurb by this man, but I promise you I liked it before he blurbed me. And his name's Thomas C. Foster, and it's called How to Read Literature Like a Professor. And it is a book for the general reader. It's a book for high school students about some of the ways that people, academics and people who teach, how they approach a work and the kinds of rigors they bring to it. And it's really marvelous. It's a great introduction. And it's very lively, and it's got a very eclectic reading list. So yes, I'm very glad you said that, because I was being a little overly flip about the reading uncritically. I think that's only valuable when it's a choice.
Just two final comments?
Yes, please.
It's about the Odyssey. I would disagree with you that the Odyssey, Odysseus gets a C in getting home, because he has trouble getting home because of something he did back in Troy, which got Poseidon very mad at
him.
He
did.
And was determined to destroy him in coming back home. So I would have given him an A for surviving what was an impossible task of facing Poseidon's rage and making it through.
I would just ask you, when he decides to stay with Circe for a year and have sex and eat her food, that's all on him, right?
I would respond to that by just one comment. In a way, the most interesting line in the Odyssey is the opening line. And there's one word that there that's very important, which is really impossible to translate into English. The opening line is Andra moi enepe musa. Polutropos hont mala pola. Tell me of Muse, of that man. And here's the word, polutropos. We don't know how to translate this. Usually the translation is the man of many wiles.
Yep.
But you know what tropism means, tendencies. Odysseus is a very strange man in ancient Greece. And Homer doesn't know how to describe him in this sense. And say, well, he has odd ideas.
Yeah.
In a traditional society, here's a guy who you don't know what he's going to do next.
Yes.
And that's why he sometimes makes odd choices. In a way, he's sort of a proto-modern.
Yeah.
Because he thinks for himself, which is what no one else in the Homeric world does.
It's a wonderful point. Well, I will say that if anyone needed their faith in humanity and the humanities restored, the fact that we're sitting in a bookstore on a cold night and you're reciting in Greek the first lines of Homer is a tonic in and of itself. So I thank you.